Hey, what's up guys? It's Tips and I'm very excited to be back with another video. But before I get started, I just wanted to give you guys a friendly reminder. If you guys have been getting burned out recently, if you guys have been working really hard, not taking too much time off, just remember it's always worth it to take a break. Your health is the most important thing. And if you're ever feeling like you're just completely burdened by something, take a step back, breathe, take some time off, because at the end of the day, it's never really worth it to push yourself that hard. But without further ado, let's go ahead and get started on this video. This video will be my Classic WoW Beta final review and summary. In case you guys missed it, the Classic WoW Beta officially ended on July 12th, a couple of days ago. That was last Friday, and now it's pretty much done. We've got a little bit to do before the Classic launch happens on August 27th, but for the most part, this is the last real taste of Classic WoW that we will be getting prior to launch. But we'll talk about what's coming up at the end of this video, and I'll also give you guys some updates on my future content. But for now, let's go ahead and get started with the full beta summary, and I'll be talking about the beta from start to finish, guys. So this is definitely going to be a more podcasty type video. Basically, if you guys have something to do, feel free to put me on the other monitor, do things around the house, go ahead and work on anything else. I'm just going to go ahead and ramble from here on out. So let's get started first and foremost with the beta summary. So the Classic WoW beta launched on May 15th and it concluded once again on July 12th. It lasted approximately 2 months, and to compare that to previous World of Warcraft betas, previous WoW betas typically last between 3 to 7 months, depending on what constitutes the beta. Usually, especially with like more modern WoW expansions, betas have been combined with alphas or have been used right after alphas, and they usually last around 3 to 4 months, whereas the alpha phase usually lasts around 3 months as well. So depending on how you define beta, the Classic WoW beta was either a third the length of a typical beta or about 2/3 the length of a typical Blizzard beta. And I think that's perfectly fine in terms of duration. In fact, I think it dragged on a little bit towards the end. There was very little content to test and, you know, consume by the end of it. At first, when the beta launched on May 15th, it went to level 30 and it was capped at level 30. Although you could explore all of the zones in Azeroth, nothing in terms of continents was capped off. On June 4th, a couple of weeks after launch, the level cap was raised to 40, at which point mounts were purchasable and a lot of classes got their big major talent point at the end of their talent tree for a specific spec. So that allowed us to test a lot more content, especially on a class by class basis. On June 14th to June 17th, an AV weekend took place, meaning that Alterac Valley opened up for everybody and we were allowed to test AV over that weekend. Pretty fun. I enjoyed the AV testing, but that was the only time we got to do it. Aside from that, we had a couple of stress tests. On Wednesday, May 22nd to the 23rd, we had stress test number one. On June 19th to June 20th, we had stress test number two. The final stress test will happen in a couple of weeks, I believe on July 25th to 26th. That one, in terms of level, as far as I know, will be uncapped. And I think Blizzard's going to try to simulate an actual launch for that stress test. So everybody, or at least a huge amount of people, as far as I know, that have opted into the beta will be allowed to participate in that stress test. So those also occurred during this period of time. And I would say the biggest target for the stress test was to test the layering system. I talked about layering in a previous video. I'll talk about it more here. I'm just trying to hit all the beta summary points one by one, just so you guys know exactly what took place over these past couple of months. In terms of what was available for testing, aside from the levels, all classes were available for testing. All races were available for testing. The following dungeons were available: RFC, Dead Mines, Wailing Cavern, Shadowfang Keep, Black Fathom Depths, Gnomeregon, Scarlet Monastery, RFK, RFD, Uldamon, and Zul'Farrok. A couple of other dungeons were available as well, like Mardon and Sunken Temple, and a couple of groups did those dungeons, but they weren't done by the vast majority of beta testers, so those I consider to still be a little bit untested. Additionally, we got to test Warsong Gulch in terms of battlegrounds. We got to test AV over that weekend. We tested Arathi Basin, and all of the professions were available for testing too, all the way up to level 300. However, some profession items were unable to be tested because they have level requirements. And the example that I'll give here is the Engineering Reflector Trinkets, the Frost Reflector, the Flame Reflector, the Shadow Reflector. All of those have level requirements higher than level 40, so we were unable to test items like that and how they worked in Classic WoW versus like private servers and stuff like that. The content that was not tested for the classic WoW beta. And this is probably one of the most important parts of the video. We did not get to test level 40 to level 60 content for the most part. We were able to do some, you know, quests that were made for like level 44 or 45 characters and Feralos and stuff like that. But the vast majority of content from level 40 to level 60 in terms of questing was not tested. We did not sufficiently test Maradon or Sunken Temple, despite some groups attempting to do them and pulling it off. We did not get to test Blackrock Depths, just because once again, some people set foot in them, but we weren't able to clear it sufficiently. I don't think anybody set foot in Scholomance or Stratholme. Nobody set foot in UBRS or LBRS. And as far as I know, all raid content was not tested, obviously, because the level cap was level 40. So Molten Core and Onyxia for phase one were not tested, and all the subsequent raids as well were not tested either, including world bosses. In terms of zone content, we were not able to test Searing Gorge, Burning Steps, Eastern Plaguelands, Western Plaguelands, Winterspring, Fellwood, Feralos, Blasted Lands, Silithus, or Un'Goro. Some of those zones do have quests that were available at level 40, and some of those quests were completed, but the entirety of those zones, in my opinion, still remains thoroughly untested. So this is the content that, when Classic WoW goes live, a lot of it will have only been tested in-house at Blizzard HQ. No one really got to test it from the public side of things. So it's just something to keep in mind in case bugs come up later down the line. In terms of the amount of bug reports that were submitted, I believe Blizzard said over 17,000 bug reports were submitted during the course of the beta or something along those lines. Hundreds of bugs were fixed from the start of beta. I played beta on day one all the way through to the end, and I will tell you, beta day one was very different from beta day, you know, 58 or 59 or whatever it was at the end. Big shout out to the people who made this changelog. In fact, I think the guy's name is, let me pull it up here real quick. Jammin' Love put together a classic changelog, which documents unofficial changes made to the classic beta during its, you know, appearance. Basically, all of the bug fixes that happened, or at least all the bug fixes that were noticed by the community, they've been all placed here in this amazing log. I'm going to link this Reddit post in the description below so you guys can check it out. But shout out to this guy for putting this post together. An additional shout out to Meiji, Klimp, Dive, BDS, and everyone else that contributed to this document. In case you guys were wondering what changed during the course of beta, here it is right here laid out in front of us. It is unofficial. Obviously, we're not going to be able to see everything because Blizzard didn't peel back the curtain for us. But in terms of what the community noticed was changed during the course of beta, this is pretty much all of it right here. Hundreds of different changes and bug fixes happened during the course of beta. Some examples of the bug fixes that occurred, just to give you guys an idea of what was changed during the beta. Existing content from the BFA client was continuously stripped. So remember, guys, Classic WoW, the version that we'll be receiving in August, it's not an original 1.12 client from back in the early days of vanilla. Obviously, it's been 15 years, and those old clients don't really work as well as they should, and they're very buggy and they crash. So Blizzard decided to take the current 8.0 client, the BFA client, and downport it while putting all of the features and gameplay of vanilla into that existing client. So as a result, a lot of leftover, you know, I don't want to say garbage, but a lot of leftover features from the BFA client still remained in the classic beta when we got to test it. Things like the ability to suggest invite, for somebody to be able to suggest an invite to a group leader to invite another person to a group, that is a modern WoW feature that is not a classic WoW feature. And subsequently, that was removed during the course of the classic beta. Some UI fixes like the scrolling combat text. I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but over the years, and the first time I really noticed it, I think was Warlords of Draenor. The scrolling combat text, whenever you do damage or something like that to a mob, it changed. And the way it kind of pops out changed significantly. And I think it actually looks a lot worse now in Modern WoW than it did back in vanilla. That was changed during the course of beta to look more like it did back in vanilla, where it's a lot more explosive and dynamic and it pops out when you hit a really big crit. So very, very good. Additionally, console command exploits and some macro exploits were fixed during the course of beta. Animation fixes like strafing. The way strafing works in Modern WoW is very different, or at least visually different, than it did back in vanilla. That was also fixed during the course of beta to restore the authentic classic WoW, vanilla WoW strafe animation. And obviously a ton of different class bugs. I mean, hunters in particular were so broken day one of the beta, and some people will argue are still broken by the end of beta, to the point that Blizzard actually released a blue post specifically mollifying the fears of all hunters out there, telling them, hey, look, we understand there's a lot of problems with hunters, and we're going to try to get these problems fixed before launch. So a lot of different class bugs were fixed. Warriors had a couple of bugs. My favorite bug, I wish it stayed, was when you charged, if you had a slowing effect on you, the slowing effect would not apply. So you would still charge and intercept at full speed. Obviously a bug. It wasn't that case back in the back in vanilla, so they fixed that pretty promptly. Bunch of different class bugs. I'm not going to go over them all. You can once again check out the classic changelog if you guys are interested. So that's pretty much the beta summary and what happened and the bugs that were fixed. Obviously the bug fixes are pretty extensive. You guys can check those out, but I'm going to give you guys my kind of short TLDR major beta takeaways. Starting off with number one, most of the vanilla WoW guides that are on YouTube, on, you know, God knows what websites, they're wrong. Or at least they have a lot of incorrect information in them. Not gonna lie, my guides included. A couple of my grind spot guides, like the Crimson Whelps in Wetlands, dude, those armor values and the abilities they have in Classic WoW are very different than they are on private servers. And as a result, I'm gonna be completely removing those videos because honestly, they're not right anymore. I've noticed specifically a lot of class leveling guides are completely moot now. A lot of them that were made based on private server information. I said grind spot guides, PvE guides, PvP guides. Basically any guide that has to do with class mechanics specifically, you can pretty much throw those out the window because the way a lot of abilities work in classic versus private servers is very different. And I'll give you a couple of examples. For example, warriors. If you guys watch any warrior leveling guide or any warrior PvE guide, you'll find something called hamstring kiting, which is essentially a method of kiting a mob while using hamstring to reduce the amount of auto attacks that mob does to you while you're waiting for your weapon swing timer to reset. Hamstring kiting does not really work in Classic WoW because of melee leeway and spell batching. And, you know, you can ask any big warrior that played on the beta. You can ask Monkey News or Tribe or any of those guys. Basically, hamstring kiting is pretty much useless for the vast majority of leveling in Classic WoW as a warrior. So it's just an example of some of the things that are wrong with these currently existing guides. I'm going to be making some new guides to replace some of my old ones and also new ones to fill in the gaps of the content that I haven't done so far. But definitely be careful of all of the guides you watch, including my own. Unless they were done post the Classic WoW beta by somebody who played in the beta, I would remain a little bit skeptical because, again, this private servers had so much wrong with them, more than even I expected. And yeah, it changes the gameplay a lot. Next major takeaway from the beta. Dungeon leveling is insanely efficient. Very, very efficient. And that has to do with primarily two things. Number one, experience gained from dungeons is actually a little bit higher in Classic WoW than it is on most private servers. And at the same time, the mobs in dungeons are a little bit weaker in Classic WoW than they are on private servers, possibly due to the fact that private servers took original or older versions of the dungeons before patch 1.12 and used those values on their 1.12 clients. But the reality is in patch 1.12, as it was back in vanilla, the mobs and dungeons are a lot weaker and the experience gain is a lot higher. And I'll give you an exact example here. Just a couple of days ago, a couple of friends and I got together. We put together a five-man group and we did RFC runs from level 12 to level 16. Level 12 to level 16 took us about 2.5 hours to do. Now, let me give you a little bit of a benchmark to compare here. Joanna, the hunter, you guys know him, the original vanilla world record speedrunner. Joanna's 12 to 16 took around 3 hours and 10 minutes to do. So 2 hours and 30 minutes for a full five-man guild group versus 3 hours and 10 minutes solo on a hunter. Yeah, grinding dungeons is incredibly efficient, and you're going to be seeing a lot of that once Classic launches. You know, it's just faster for the most part for most classes, and even for the classes where it's not faster, it's still better to get 5 people to level up in a dungeon group if you're in a guild. It's obviously a lot better having 5 level 60s than just having 1 level 60 who got there a little bit faster. The third takeaway that I would say you guys should know about before going into Classic is melee leeway. I'm sure you guys have probably read a million posts about this on the forums, on the Reddits. You might have watched Perplexity's video, which I thought was an amazing video covering the topic. But basically, melee leeway is a very big deal. I've already explained how it affects warriors when it comes to hamstring kiting. It affects Taurens dramatically because Taurens, as a result, you know, having naturally longer range than other races, they have exceptionally long range now. They can reach you from the other side of the world. And a great example of this was during the last dueling tournament that I hosted. Sony Digital, who plays a Tauren warrior, was basically able to auto attack a hunter with their trap in between them. It was insane. Like, it did not make any sense, but that was a mechanic back in vanilla, so it is staying in Classic WoW. Another example of leeway coming into effect is hunters are much easier to dead zone. Basically, the distance that a hunter has to get before he can auto shot you is a little bit longer, 2 yards longer. So it's a lot easier to dead zone a hunter now. Rogues can't crippling poison kite quite as easily anymore because melee leeway and the ranges are so small. And beyond just melee, it also affects spellcasters. Things like Frost Nova, because of melee leeway, Frost Nova actually has a slightly larger radius when used in PvP or PvE when a mob is moving. Hunter traps have a larger radius with moving targets. Basically, whenever you are moving in Classic WoW, any spell or ability has a 2 yard longer range. So just keep that in mind. It's going to affect gameplay dramatically, especially PvP. Next major takeaway, and got a couple more of these, there's two more of these left. The next major takeaway is layering. So layering is going to come to Classic WoW. The last video I made, guys, was about layering. Since that video, it looks like Blizzard decided to go with option number three, or solution number three, that I called out in that video. Layering has been significantly improved and now has its own internal cooldown timer, which prevents people from layer hopping to avoid PvP ganks. And when it comes to exploiting resources in the world, prevents people from systematically hopping from layer to layer to layer to loot things like mining nodes or chest nodes and stuff like that in the world. It doesn't really work that way anymore. You can no longer avoid ganks with layering. And when it comes to hopping over layers, every time you hop over a layer, an increased cooldown happens where even if you group up with somebody on a different layer, you won't layer over for a significant amount of time. It takes, you know, a minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, depending on how many times you've layer hopped recently. So layering, I would say, has been fixed like 70% of the way. I think now it's by and large the best solution to handle the Classic WoW launch compared to all of the other alternatives that were suggested before. Is it perfect? Absolutely not. You know, could it be better? Of course it could be. But I think it's one of those things that at this point it's a necessary evil and we just got to hope it only lasts a couple of weeks. And as a reminder, it will not be in phase two as well. So that being said, it will affect gameplay. And the biggest way it'll affect gameplay, in my opinion, is the fact that layering means bigger populations than you might be used to in retail WoW. The way layering works is essentially a server will take 2,000 to 3,000 people, put them in one continent, one Azeroth, before generating a new layer for the next 2,000 to 3,000 people to populate on that server before generating a new layer and so on and so forth. Essentially what that means is on August 27th, when you log into Classic WoW, there'll be around 3,000 people most likely on your layer competing for the same mobs. And that is going to be incredibly competitive. It's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be really fun to see and watch and play. But at the same time, it's gonna make leveling, especially in those early days of Classic launch, a lot harder. So what I would say is if you guys are mapping out routes for you and your group, if you're solo leveling, duo leveling, group leveling, whatever it may be, make sure to keep in mind that you're probably going to be competing with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of other people during those initial starting zones. So maybe it might be a good idea to skip the quests that require, you know, everybody in the group to collect something or to kill, you know, a certain amount of mobs and stuff like that. Try to aim for the quests that are easy single kill quests, quests that are exploration quests, delivery quests, stuff like that. Things that it doesn't really matter how many people are doing them in your area, you'll still be able to pull them off. So just keep that in mind. Finally, dozens of small class differences. I mentioned the hamstring kiting and some of the Frost Nova with the leeway mechanics. The way Cone of Cold works, Cone of Cold is aimed very differently in Classic WoW than it is on private servers. Rogue Stealth operates very differently. I'm not sure if it's because of batching or just because of the stealth mechanic as a whole. It's a lot easier to detect stealthies now than it is on private servers, and it's very easy to break somebody out of stealth once they've gone into stealth. Very frustrating for rogue players, but if you hate rogues, then you're in a bit of luck. You've got a little bit more of an advantage against them in situations like that. Another difference, Hunter, Scattershot, Frost Trap share diminishing returns, meaning that a Hunter can no longer Scattershot you into a Frost Trap. I mean, he can, but those two abilities are on DR, so the Frost Trap only lasts like 4 seconds, which won't give the Hunter enough time to get the distance to start attacking you again if you have a snare on him, like a hamstring or something like that. So a lot of these small class differences that are just different than they are on private servers, tons of them. And it's difficult to go through all of them. You can check the document, but it's something that you're just going to have to experience once Classic goes live and compare it to your private server experience, if you have any, by the way. I'm just pointing this stuff out there for the people that have played private servers, because I know a lot of you guys have. So I'm just putting that out there just so you guys know what you're going into. So those are pretty much my major beta takeaways. I'll summarize them again real quick. Most of the gods on the internet are wrong. Dungeon leveling is insanely efficient. Melee leeway is a big deal. Spell batching changes gameplay. Layering will impact leveling, will make it a lot slower. Dozens of small class differences. But yeah, those are my big beta takeaways, guys. But overall, I thought the beta was great. Blizzard are very efficient in fixing a lot of the bugs. But there were some things that are still kind of outstanding, and this is what I'll transition into right now. The biggest questions about Classic going into the launch. Question number one for me is layering, believe it or not. Is layering going to receive any other changes? And will we know exactly the size of every layer? I mentioned 2,000 to 3,000 previously. That's the expected size of the layer, because that's how big approximately vanilla WoW servers were back in the day. And we were told that each layer will have a realm's worth of population on it. But the reality is, we don't know how big layers are going to be. And on top of that, we don't know how all the layers are going to be combined once they get rid of the layering system. Are they just going to take, you know, everybody on the server and throw them into one layer regardless of how big the server is? What if one of the servers happens to be huge and you've got 20,000 people playing on it? Are 20,000 people across like 20 different layers going to be thrown together once layering is disabled? Or are people going to be in queue times? We still don't know how that's going to work. And I hope we get some clarification on that going into launch. Number two, server population sizes. That kind of goes hand in hand with the layering thing, but we still don't know how big the servers are going to be. Again, back in vanilla, the server sizes were 2,000 to 3,000. On private servers like Nostalrius, those numbers eclipsed 15,000 concurrent players. How big are they going to be for Classic WoW? Are we going to get these monstrous mega servers with thousands of people across Orgrimmar and Ironforge? Are we going to get something a little bit more Blizz-like, vanilla-like, you know, 2,000 to 3,000 server population caps? We're not really sure yet, so who knows? The next thing is hunters. Poor hunters, man. Poor hunters. Hunters were pretty buggy during the beta, to say the least. They got a lot better by the end of it, but they still have a lot of problems that are being addressed right now by Blizzard. I guess hunters, you know, especially with the pet mechanic and stuff like that, there's just a lot of things that aren't working properly. And Blizzard mentioned this in a recent blue post, saying that they're aware of a lot of current issues with the hunter class, and they're doing their best to fix those issues going into launch. I guess I'll link that blue post in the description below if you're a hunter player, if you want to see what's still outstanding about that class. But definitely a big question mark on hunters right now. I feel like of all the classes so far, hunters got the biggest nerf, I guess you could say, or at least the way they actually work back in vanilla is a lot less powerful than it is on private servers. So hunter players, be wary of that. The next big question, Warsong Gulch. So during the Classic beta, as I said before, we did get to test Warsong Gulch in Arathi base and an AV, but because there were so few people invited to the beta, Warsong Gulch in particular was like barely tested. During that time, a lot of bugs were found, but because very few people were testing it, not a lot of those bugs were reported. And I'll give you some examples of these bugs. Certain items or certain abilities triggering a flag drop from a flag carrier that weren't supposed to trigger a flag drop. Certain things, you know, certain abilities that are supposed to drop the flag, not dropping the flag. Certain things like extra jumps and the ability to, you know, get over the map or underneath the map that weren't available back in vanilla. Some of that was exposed during the beta too. So Warsong Gulch, I feel, was, you know, it didn't seem like it had the appropriate attention it deserved. And again, that's just because there weren't that many people, you know, on the server to begin with to queue up and to test it, unfortunately. But that being said, Warsong doesn't come out until phase 3, so I expect Blizzard probably has it a little bit lower priority than some of the issues like the Hunter issues, but hopefully that gets addressed before Warsong actually comes out. And finally, the biggest question going into Classic, all of the untested content that I mentioned before, the level 40 to 60 leveling content, the endgame dungeons, Uber, Skolo, Strat, you know, that we didn't get to test, the raids, Molten Core, Onyxia. None of that got tested during the beta. It's obviously being ingested. Okay, it's obviously being tested at Blizzard HQ right now by the Classic WoW QAQC team, but the public didn't get their hands on it. And obviously, when it comes to testing, you want as many hands on something as possible. So I'm curious, you know, curious to see how Blizzard goes about this. Do they open up some kind of testing just for this untested content? I don't think that's going to happen. I think we're just pretty much going to get whatever they test internally. But at the end of the day, that is, I guess, a big question mark. So we'll see how all that content, that endgame content, comes out. That was the Classic beta. What do we have between now, you know, July 16th and the launch date? First and foremost, we have a stress test between July 25th and July 26th. This is going to be the last stress test before launch. It's going to be pretty major. I'm pretty sure a lot of people are going to be able to get in, so make sure you've opted into the beta in your Battle.net settings. After that, on August 13th, Blizzard will open up name reservations. So if you are subscribed to World of Warcraft on August 13th, you will be able to reserve your name, actually up to 3 names, on any of the announced servers, which will be announced at that time as well, I think. So you'll be able to reserve your name on those servers for Classic WoW. So if you have a name, like a popular name, like, I don't know, Harry Potter or something like that, you can reserve that on a specific server on August 13th. That's pretty much the last major event we have before the final event, Classic Launch, which is on August 27th. So for your calendars, again, July 25th, July 26th, stress test, August 13th, name reservation, and August 27th is the launch. So definitely mark those in your calendars. Whew. And that's pretty much it on my document here. I hope I didn't miss anything. I'll give you guys kind of like my final thoughts on everything about this beta. And this video is basically like 5 videos being smashed into one. I apologize for that. The whole reason for this video and combining all these topics was that I didn't have to clutter your guys' video feeds with just like beta videos and, you know, my takeaways on the beta and, you know, my thoughts on the final beta event and blah, blah, blah. I didn't want to do all of those videos, so I figured I'd pack them all into one. But as far as my final thoughts go, guys, I was pretty happy with the beta overall. As I said before, I thought it was great. I thought they fixed a lot of things. I think Classic WoW is in very good hands. And I'll tell you, I never thought I would ever say that when it comes to Activision, okay? But I personally believe, and this is just a theory, who knows? I personally believe that Activision probably is not too aware of how successful Classic is, or at least how popular it is. And the reason why I say that is during an earnings call, a couple of earnings calls ago, they were talking about their mainline product releases, and they didn't mention Classic WoW. They don't consider it a mainline product. So I guess we're kind of lucky that Activision might not see Classic WoW as this big, you know, important thing, because it probably means they're keeping their hands off of it and letting Blizzard do what Blizzard does. And in this case, when it comes to Blizzard, they've got a great team on this project. Omar Gonzalez, phenomenal. Brian Birmingham, phenomenal. Everybody else that's a part of the team, man, that I personally don't know or haven't met and we haven't heard from, but guys like Bornak, KVAX, all the community guys, they are being very, very hands-on with the community on this, and they've been a pleasure to play with on the beta and stuff like that, and these guys freaking care about this game. And that is why I think that Classic WoW is going to be incredible. I mean, when you compare now to the fears that we had a year ago, you know, talking about LFR and no changes and don't bring transmog to Classic and keep, you know, all of the store mounts and the cash shops away from Classic, we're so far beyond that point now. We're talking about the nitty-gritty, you know, certain class mechanics and certain abilities, really small things here and there. I think that's a very, very good sign that Classic WoW was in fact put in the correct hands. And a big shout out to everybody on the Classic team for the amazing work you guys have done. It's been phenomenal playing and testing the game. And an even bigger shout out to everybody in the community who's participated in keeping up with the beta, testing things, offering feedback, offering alternatives to layering and sharding and all that stuff. Everybody in the community that has been involved in Classic before it actually launched, you guys are the real MVPs, honestly. So thank you guys so much for being as active as you guys are and as vocal as you guys are, because at the end of the day, we got here by being vocal, not by being silent. Very exciting times ahead, guys. August 27th, I'll be playing Classic WoW all day, every day. I'll be streaming it all day, every day. And in the time between now and then, I've got a lot of videos to make. It's about time I get back to the YouTube game. I mentioned at the start of the video a little bit, guys, or at least, you know, may have indicated it in one form or another. The past couple of weeks, you know, after playing the beta for an extensive period of time, things came up behind the scenes. I've been working a lot of exciting projects, of course, but at the same time, I just need to step away a little bit. Health-wise, I felt like, you know, a lot of pains on my stomach and stuff like that. I put on a lot of weight, and I'm trying to take that weight off right now. It's pretty frustrating, but I got to get into shape, you know, got to get into somewhat decent shape before a Classic, so when Classic comes out and I completely veg out, I don't freaking get cardiac arrest or anything like that, you know what I'm saying? So I'm trying to, you know, manage the weight right now, so I'm not just a complete, you know, 800-pound degenerate when Classic comes out. But yeah, we're taking it one day at a time. But I'm very excited to come back to YouTube, guys. I'm still going to be streaming on Twitch. But before I start streaming again on Twitch, a little bit of an announcement. I am heading out today, later on today, to the world first race in Krefeld, Germany. I'll be with Method and S-Fan at the world first race over there. I'll be doing some casting. S-Fan and I will be hosting a Classic WoW show on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday this week at the world first race. Very excited for it. So I'm going to be in Germany for the next week or so. But once I get back, I'll be streaming hopefully regularly every day. Got to finish those deep dives, got to finish class overviews, and I got a couple of events planned as well before the Classic WoW launch too. So hopefully a lot of things to be excited for in the meantime. But yeah, guys, that's pretty much it for today. 38-minute video, dear God. I'll try to cut out as much as I can. I'm sure I repeated myself a lot. I've been doing that a lot lately. I apologize for that, but frigate, it's just good to be back, man. New mic, by the way, new green screen. Gonna make use of it in the next videos. And I just don't want to stop it, dude. I'm just really happy to be back. But I will stop it. I will spare you guys these ramblings. Thank you guys so much for your support over the past year and a half. You guys have been absolutely phenomenal. Thank you to everyone who subscribed during the droughts and the content droughts and stuff like that. Love you guys. For more Classic WoW content news and updates, you guys can follow me on Twitter. You guys can join the Discord, or you can catch me live on Twitch. All the links are in the description below. And if you guys have any questions, feel free to DM me anytime. I'm going to head out for now. I got some packing and stuff to do today. But thanks for watching the video. I'll see you guys in the next one. And as always, tips out, baby. Take care.